Yeah, I'm ready.
I'm just waiting for Professor Kumaril to say yes.
You've done. I am ready, madam.
Yeah, so, yeah, fine. Thank you. Good afternoon, everybody. It gives me immense pleasure as the coordinator for these distinguished lecture series to be inviting all of you to the fourth distinguished lecture series in the decennial celebrations of CUTN. We have crossed 10-year mark and we are into our 11th year of establishment of CUTN. And the first three speakers have been Professor Ram Ramaswamy, who was the previous Vice Chancellor of HCU. And the next was Sonal Mansingh, our esteemed Rajya Sabha member and one of the Navaratnas of the current government. Our third speaker was Professor P. Ramaswamy, who has been the Vice Chancellor of AC University. And now we are extremely happy to be inviting Dr. Vaidya Subramaniam for delivering this fourth distinguished lecture series. And he is the Vice Chancellor of Shastra University and also the Tata Consultancy Services Chair Professor of Management at the Shastra Deemed University, Punjab. He is an alumnus of the Harvard Business School with interest in public policy and higher education management. He obtained his PhD in the area of MBA education in India as a visiting scholar at the University of Virginia, and an MBA from Asian Institute of Management, Manila, Philippines. His BE in Electronics and Instrumentation was from Bhatidasan University. He has had many years of corporate work experience, having worked with the Siemens India, Meralco Philippines, and Johnson & Johnson of US and India. He is also a member of many Government of India committees, Confederation of the Indian Industry, Southern Region and Tamil Nadu, as well as committees on higher education and various academic bodies. He's a recipient of the Young Manager Award-winning team member, Madras Management Associations. He's been a resource person for the Lee Kuan Yew School of Public Policy, National University of Singapore, and Asian Development Bank member and academic bodies of various colleges. He's, in addition to all this, he writes for many dailies as a columnist and is an author of Express Writings, a three-volume book focusing on education policy. We are indeed very happy to be inviting you to be delivering this distinguished lecture, sir. And I request our officiating Vice Chancellor, Professor Kartik Murugan, to say a few introductory remarks before we hear the talk.
So, good afternoon, distinguished speaker and esteemed Vice Chancellor of Shastra University, Professor Vaidya Subramaniam, Professor Madhurima, the event coordinator, deans, heads, officers, faculty members, staff, scholars, and students. It gives me great pleasure and privilege to extend a very warm welcome to the distinguished speaker and the esteemed Vice Chancellor of Shastra University for this decennial distinguished lecture on my own behalf as well as on behalf of the Central University of Tamil Nadu. It is indeed a great pleasure that we have a very outstanding academician and a very renowned representative of a renowned institution nearby to our Central University of Tamil Nadu as the guest of honor for our today's decennial distinguished lecture. And just I would like to speak few words about the Shastra University, which is represented by the distinguished speaker as the Vice Chancellor, and also about our Central University of Tamil Nadu as a brief introduction to the speaker as a way of introducing our university to him. Shastra Deemed University, all of you may be knowing well, it was started in 1984 in the name and style of Shanmuga College of Engineering, affiliated to Bharathidasan University, Trichy. Time I was working in Bharathidasan University as the head of the department and as the dean. At that time itself, the Shanmuga College of Engineering had its own outstanding reputation. Then it was renamed as Shanmuga Arts and Science, Technology and Research Academy. And for your kind information, it was the first institution to get the deemed university status in the state of Tamil Nadu. And Srinivasa Ramanuja Center at Kumbakonam is also attached to Sastra University. And Thanjavur, the moment we speak about Thanjavur, two things come to our mind. One is a big temple, there is no temple, and another one is Sastra University. And data speak volumes about the achievements of the university. In 2011, the software company Tata Consultancy Services set a world record of recruiting as many as 1,755 students from Sastra, the largest recruitment by any company in the entire world from a single campus, single organization. So that shows the credibility and the visibility and the reputation which the Sastra University enjoys at the national level as well as at the international level. And in terms of ranking also, NIRF ranking at the university's level in 2020, it has been ranked at the 25th rank. And at the college ranking also in 2020, it has got a very high ranking. And among the engineering institutions, it has been ranked at 37th rank, 37th among engineering colleges in India by the National Institutional Ranking Framework, NIRF, in 2020, 25th among universities, and 48th in the overall ranking. So these are all because of the outstanding contributions, dedication, and devotion made by the Chancellor as well as the Vice-Chancellor. Chancellor Professor Sethuraman and the Vice Chancellor Professor Vaidya Subramaniam. So that way, we are really fortunate to have a great legacy represented by Sastra University as a speaker for today's program. And I am very much delighted to extend a very warm welcome to him on my own behalf and on behalf of every one of you. In fact, I have been trying to get the date from the Vice Chancellor for a very long time. Ever since we started the decennial celebration, I have been in touch with him, and somehow or other he was found to be very busy, extremely busy, and today at last it got materialized, and we are really very fortunate. And once again, thank you, sir, for having accorded your valuable contributions and your precious time. And you have made it amidst your very busy schedules. Now, I would like to give you a brief introduction about the Central University of Tamil Nadu to the speaker. The CUTN, the Central University of Tamil Nadu, started in 2009, has now grown like a banyan tree. As of now, the teaching and research activities of the Central University of Tamil Nadu are now conducted in 12 major schools, namely School of Social Sciences and Humanities, School of Basic and Applied Sciences, School of Mathematics and Computer Sciences, School of Behavioral Sciences, School of Commerce and Business Management, School of Communication, School of Education and Training, School of Technology, School of Performing Arts and Fine Arts, and School of Health Sciences, School of Legal Studies, and School of Life Sciences, which altogether consist of 27 departments. Departments of Applied Psychology, Chemistry, Commerce, Computer Science, Economics, Education, English, Epidemiology, Public Health, Epidemiology and Public Health, Geography, Geology, Hindi, History, Horticulture and Floriculture, Law, Library and Information Science, Life Sciences, Management, Material Science, Mathematics, Media and Communication, Microbiology, Music, Physics, Social Work, Statistics, and Applied Mathematics. Tamil, Tourism and Hospitality Management. So the university offers one undergraduate program, 6 integrated programs, 22 postgraduate programs, 14 MPhil programs, 26 PhD programs. Comprised in 12 schools. So in addition, one undergraduate program and 8 postgraduate programs are offered through Madras School of Economics, Chennai, and Sir Vallabhai Patel, International School of Textiles and Management, Coimbatore, who have an MOU with the CUTN. So that way, our university is, I should say, 10 year young. And we have many more miles to grow, many more miles to cross, and we have many more innings to achieve. And we are in the process of making all-round development in all the domains, teaching, research, and extension. And in the ranking also, we are trying our best to achieve. See, in the last NIR of 2020 ranking, we have been ranked at 101 to 150 in overall ranking. And among the newly started central universities across the country, after 2009, the Central University of Tamil Nadu has relatively fared very well. And it is because of the teamwork, a set of dedicated faculty and staff, and a very committed group of scholars, the students who are representing the entire country, I should say, from Kashmir to Kanyakumari, all the states have been represented. So that cultural plurality is the hallmark of our Central University of Tamil Nadu. And it is our diversity in students' population, the cosmopolitan atmosphere, all these things give the major strength for the Central University of Tamil Nadu. So that way, after this COVID-19 pandemic crisis, I look forward to receiving the physical presence of Professor Vaidya Subramaniam in person to visit our university and to offer his valuable guidance and support for further development of our university. So coming to the topic value chain in education, so it has the concept value has various connotations from different angles. It is a very complex, multidimensional concept. In educational parlance, we talk about value education. And we used to say, values cannot be taught, values have to be caught. So a teacher should be an embodiment of values. Even in this technological era, it is said that the Gurukula period is the golden period in the history of not only Indian education, but global education. Because in the Gurukula system of education, the guru was not only a teacher, but a friend, philosopher, and guide, and he practiced what he preached. That is the most important thing. So simplicity, dedication, devotion. So all the students resided in the ashram and with utter austerity. And so that way, the holistic development of multidimensional cognitive, affective, psychomotor values, all the values have been developed. And that is the major criticism against the contemporary education. Even in the National Policy on Education 2020, the criticism has been mentioned and measures have been suggested how to provide holistic, comprehensive education, which addresses not only cognitive development, but also affective development and psychomotor development. So how people's emotional development. See, just I would like to quote from, one quote which I used to remember very significantly. What we need today is not loaded learning, but utter integrity. What we need today is not a man as a brilliant beast, but what we need is a man with compassion, a man with values. So that way it is very essential that science and technology, education should address not only the cognitive development, but also the affective development. So it is one thing which is, and it is often said, a teacher who teaches the value of non-smoking for 1 hour, at the end of the lecture, if he goes and smokes for 1 minute, the whole teaching has become will become a colossal waste. So it is very essential that we should practice what we preach. And the younger generations of today, threatened by the media, social media, Web 2 technologies, they become technology addicts, and who has to take care of the value aspect in higher education has become a very big million-dollar question. So erosion of values in society has been pointed out by international organizations like UNESCO and the national level, Ministry of Education, and in all the national policies. Ever since we got independence, we had Dr. Radhakrishnan Education Commission report, Dr. Kothari Education Commission report, the National Policy on Education 1968, and then the National Policy on again and again telling that higher education should concentrate on values, should give equal importance for values. The certificates we produce, the mark list we produce should be the testimony not only of the cognitive attainment, but also of the affective attainment. To what extent our students have attained the value of punctuality, attained the value of emotional maturity, and how balanced they are. So to what extent they respect the elders, or to what extent they respect the culture, Indian culture. So all these things matter very much. So that way, it is very essential that this aspect has to be addressed. And another thing, because Professor Vaidyasubramanian is a professor of management, I think this value chain, he may be addressing from the management angle also. And one thing I would like to just, I will not take much time. One thing in educational parlance, we talk about education as a system concept. System concept in the sense, education is a complex system with many subsystems. We have context variable, input variables, process variables, and output variables. And the context variable, the socio-political context in which the system is operating. And the input variables, the teacher quality, the people quality, the characteristics of the teacher, attitude of the teacher, aptitude of the teacher, how qualified he or she, and how specialized they are, how trained they are all coming under the teacher characteristics category. And students' characteristics, students' attitude, students' readiness to learn, and students' socioeconomic background, what they bring to the institution, these are all very important. And then support of agencies. See, sometimes it is very essential that teachers are there, students are there, but we should have some supporting agencies. Which help the teacher and student to ensure optimum teaching and optimum learning. So there comes the role of Ministry of Education, State Department of Education, Higher Education, and then the university departments and HRDC, Human Resource Development Centers, training agencies, and all these things. Coming under process variables, we have quality of teaching, quality of management, and quality of students' participation. And curriculum quality, that is the most important thing. So by curriculum quality, we mean the totality of learning experiences which a student receives inside and outside the institution. Then the management quality, to what extent the management is proactive, and to what extent it supports, encourages, it provides a conducive environment and ambience, encouraging the faculty, encouraging the students, all these things are there. And last one is output. And by output, we do not mean just the examination result alone. Sometimes we find that even the first class graduates, engineering graduates, they are caught in robbery, they are caught in cyber crime, and they are caught in all types of crimes. So that way it has become everyday's news in the media and the TV. So then what is the contribution of the degree he has received? So what extent the degree has imbibed values on him. So these are all the things which have to be addressed. So by output, we do not mean a narrow sense of education as examination result alone. It means more than that. To what extent the students have attained accomplishments in cognitive, affective, and psychometric, the holistic, value development, emotional development, all these things matter. So that way, this is the educational value chain from our, what we know, because we do not belong to the deeper discipline of management. So from the layman's point of view, how we perceive value chain and how we perceive the concept of value, I have just given as a brief introductory remark. So now I request the speaker to give his expert lecture on this topic to enlighten us on the new area, value chain in education, which is a very new area, very novel area, and I am sure it is a very potential area for implementation. And this decennial lecture by this distinguished speaker will just not only a formal an event for the sake of event, and his speech should be taken in letter and spirit, and it should be taken for policy making as well as for implementation by the Board of Studies, by the school boards, and by the Academic Council for implementation, for the development of the university, and for the development of higher education in this part of the country. So with these introductory remarks, I take delight in welcoming the distinguished speaker once again. I am very much thankful to you, sir, for sparing your very precious time. I know how busy you are, and you have been very kind enough to address the faculty members, scholars, and students representing the entire country. That is the important thing. Today you are addressing a national audience, sir. I can even say international audience, because some of our students are from other countries also. So that way, we are all very fortunate, and I once again welcome you. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Can I start?
Yes, please. Thank you.
Yeah, a very good evening to all the distinguished members of the wonderful CUTN family who have gotten together for this distinguished lecture series, which celebrates a very momentous achievement of the Central University of Tamil Nadu at Tiruvarur's successful completion of 10 years. And on this decennial celebrations, I wish the university all well, and they achieve more and more of success in their journey forward. At the outset, I would like to thank Dr. Madhurima, the event coordinator, for charitable introduction, and my good friend, the Vice Chancellor, Professor Karpaga Kumar Vel, who actually has raised the bar, raised the expectations of the audience in his background speech that he mentioned on the different dimensions of values. In fact, the topic educational value chain that I chose had no specific reason. To be very honest with you, when the Vice Chancellor called me a couple of weeks back, that was the day that I was also delivering my class on Michael Porter's value chain to my students. And then immediately I thought about this idea of delivering a talk on educational value chain. So the genesis of the topic, I should give credit to only Michael Porter. For those who closely follow management and strategy, the term value chain was created by Michael Porter, a very distinguished management consultant and a professor of management at the Harvard Business School, who always views an organization as a concatenation of different activities, each of which that can generate significant value. And the more and more that these activities can generate individual values, the committee of activities put together is what drives an organization's value set. And the word organization is so generic in the sense that it includes all types of organizations, whether it's profit-making entities or not for profit-making entities, or government or think tanks. All of them can easily fall under this generic organizational set. The reason is that all of them, in my opinion, are driven by three P's that I usually refer them to. That what drives the characteristic of the organization is from the policy level, which is the first P, then the process level, which is more institutional and organizational, and the people level, who are actually the foot soldiers. They are not the intellectual paratroopers, but they are the foot soldiers who will ensure that the policy that is implemented through processes is carefully taken towards the last mile when it comes to the action plan. So if you look at an organization's value chain, it is the policy, the process, and the people, all three put together in a very coherent synergy that ensures that every organization is able to deliver the value that it is supposed to deliver. Now, in the pursuit of delivering that value, an organization will have different types of stakeholders. And during the course of my lecture moving forward, I am very, very particular about three important stakeholders and more focus on higher educational institutions, namely the individual as a stakeholder in the higher education ecosystem, then the institution, which is the higher education institution itself as a stakeholder, and then finally the industry. So again, I would restrict my lecture to only these three I's concerning the individual, the institution, and industry. And the fundamental is that we should be able to make a very significant impact in those areas in which either as an individual or as an institution or as an industry, we have control over. Many times what happens, why organizations fail in delivering value, is that they are concerned about issues on which they have no control. The more and more we are concerned about issues on which we absolutely have no control, it only consumes a lot of our productive resources, but not being able to deliver the desired objective. But we flip the coin the other side and be concerned about issues on which we can exercise control, then we would be able to create a significant impact on different dimensions, touching different stakeholders in the entire educational value chain. With that as the premise, let me begin with the first I, called the individual. I would not be getting very philosophical, but since the word value is embedded in the topic itself, you might find a little bit of philosophy, you might find a little bit of policy realism, you will find a little bit of some boardroom thought processes. So it's going to be a mix of a variety of thought process in understanding the intrinsic value that needs to be generated by higher education ecosystems, beginning with the individual. Now, the question is, what is value? And if you look at the dictionary or many of the books, everybody comes out with different definitions for value. I can at this point of time only recall the definition of value that Swami Dayananda Saraswati, a very renowned saint, Swami, whose birthplace is not very far from your university, comes from Manjakudi, a small village, not very, very far from the Central University there at Thiruvaru. Swami Dayananda Saraswati defines value very, very succinctly. And I have always used this as a definition for value. A value is a value only if the value of the value is valuable to oneself. A value is a value only if the value of the value is valuable to oneself. So it is that individual who has to consider that value element to be valuable. Finally, it rests with the individual's perspective on this very abstract term called value. Now, why is this abstract, overwhelming term called value now getting restricted within an individual? The reason is very simple, that, you know, we are aware of four yugas, the Krita Yuga, the Treta Yuga, the Dwapara Yuga, and the Kali Yuga. In the Krita Yuga, the good and the evil were in two different worlds altogether. Namely, the good in the world of the Devas and the evil in the world of the Asuras. So the Krita Yuga, there was a clear distinction, and that distinction was between two different worlds. And then in the Treta Yuga, it was in two different countries. If you look at the Ramayana, you will find Ravan in Sri Lanka and Lord Rama in India. So the evil and the good distinctly separated across two different countries. Then in Dwapara Yuga, the good and the evil was in the same country, but in two different families. The good in the family of Pandavas and the evil in the family of Kauravas. So then it was in the same country, but in two different families. But the symptom of Kali Yuga, the good and the evil, is that it resides in the same individual. So every individual has a good and an evil within themselves. And that is why it is very essential for every individual to understand the value of the value from their own perspective. And only if they begin to get a feeling that that is valuable, then they can start making a difference in the society. And these are positive values, ethical values that I'm talking about. Respect for elders, respect for teachers, empathy, honesty, hard work. There is a different and a variety of value characteristics that every individual needs to enrich their value capital. But over a period of time, the sources from which they can enrich flows across different stakeholders that they engage in their lifetime, about which I'll be talking a little later. But as education institutions, one might ask, what is the fundamental value? And as Professor, the Vice Chancellor mentioned, the role of a teacher. The role of a teacher is so important in an educational institution, be it the school level or the college level or the university level. The role of a teacher is very, very important. And look at the selfless, the tireless, and definitely you will agree with me, the thankless job that teachers do. And I usually give this as an example when I explain the noble profession of teaching. And all of you, I'm sure, as members in the audience, you will remember your school time. And even today, if you take your kids to the school, you will still remember the same teaching arrangement, the seating arrangement in the classrooms. When the kids in their cages go to school, the teacher will be in the chair. The students in the KG section will be sitting on the floor. And then the students get promoted and they come to middle school, fifth, sixth, and all of that. They will have a small stool, small chair on which they will sit, while the teacher still takes that elevated position in the chair, which remains the same. It's the same position, whether it's at the KG level or at the class 3 or class 4 level. And then at the higher secondary level, you will find again the students and the teachers almost occupying the, in terms of the height of the seating chair, they almost face to face. And then when you come into the higher education, the university system, then you find a gallery type, you know, seating arrangement where the teacher's still there. And while the students, maybe you will see them somewhere at an elevated spot. Now, what is the message that I could pick out from this is that the noble profession of teaching ensures that the student elevates from their seating position, which to my mind is also the knowledge acquisition process, the intellectual position, and the teacher sits on the same place, elevates the student from one level to a senior level, and always ensures that the student constantly elevates. And this is a noble profession of teaching that we can understand merely looking at the seating position of a teacher and a progressive student. Not that the teacher is not progressing. The teacher is always progressing. And you know why a teacher always progresses? The fundamental value of a teacher to progress is that a teacher always has to remain a student. A continuous learning is a virtue of a teacher, and that ensures positive progress that will definitely result in a student's intellectual progress as they move forward. And this is just one example. Another example may be related in Tamil. Again, I would like to, you know, Swami Haridas, again, a very, very renowned Nama Sankirtan expert. And of course, he does a lot of Harikatha also. He says the role of guru, the role of teacher is very important. And he compares that with the process of lighting a lamp. Everybody knows that the teacher lights the lamp of knowledge. But then in his own style, he explains why. And I will definitely explain this in Tamil also, because it resonates well when I use the concept of lighting a lamp. So the fundamental understanding that every learner, and I'm using the word learner, whether it's a student or a teacher, so every individual learner has to have, is that there is limitless knowledge in the world around us. That there is so much that we don't know is something that we need to understand first. We have to first shed the image that we know everything. முதல்ல நமக்கு வந்து எல்லாம் தெரியுங்கிற அந்த ஒரு எண்ணத்தை விளக்க வேண்டும். தெரிய வேண்டியது இன்னும் நிறைய இருக்குங்கிற அந்த எண்ணம் வர வேண்டும். ஸோ ஃபர்ஸ்ட் நமக்கு எல்லாம் தெரியுங்கிறத விளக்க வேண்டும். Which means I need that vilakku first, the lamp first. Once you get that realization, then to learn things that you don't know, you should understand the fact that you need a guru, that you need a teacher. எனக்கு தெரியாததை நான் கற்றுக்கொள்ள வேண்டும். அதை ஒரு குரு மூலமாக தான் கற்றுக்கொள்ள முடியுங்கிற எண்ணம் வர வேண்டும். அந்த எண்ணம் வர வேண்டும். ஸோ விளக்குக்கு அப்புறம் அந்த மாதிரி எண்ணெய் வேண்டும். ஸோ எண்ணெய் தேவை. ஸோ ஒரு லேம்ப், எண்ணெய், விளக்கு, எண்ணெய், லேம்ப், ஆயில். ஒன்ஸ் யூ ரியலைஸ் தட் யூ நீட் அ டீச்சர், தென் யுவர் சர்ச் ஃபார் அ குட் டீச்சர் மஸ்ட் பிகின். யூ மஸ்ட் கோ அவுட் அண்ட் சர்ச் ஃபார் அ குட் டீச்சர். You have to go to different places. Thiriya vendum. You will have to move all to all places in search of a very good teacher. Thirinji thirinji, finally thirindathukku appra or nalla guru you have to get. Thiriya vendum. So oru thiri vendum. And the thiri kadachathukku appra, once you have found that good teacher, you have to develop a good relationship with the teacher. It is not that you paid a tuition fee and that he or she is obligated to teach. That is more a contract. We are talking about human relationship, developing a very harmonious, noble relationship between the teacher and the thought. So that feeling you have to get. ஒரு பற்று வர வேண்டும் இந்த குரு மேல். So after the theory, you have to light it up. அதை பற்ற வேண்டும். Once that glows, it has to glow for a long period of time. Once your education is complete within those four walls of this educational institution, it is only instantaneous. Then again, you should not step out of the portals of the institution and say, I know everything. What you have been given is only a degree to exit the campus. But what you need to do is to acquire more to enter life. So never have this ego that you know everything just because you got a degree. So when you leave the institution, எனக்கு எல்லாம் தெரியுங்கிற அந்த எண்ணத்தை எரிய வேண்டும். So the lamp has to keep glowing. So beginning first with விளக்கு, you need எண்ணெய், then theory, then that has to glow, பற்ற வேண்டும், and அந்த ஈகோங்கிறது எரிய வேண்டும். So this is the contrasting example that Swami Haridas Giri takes, understanding the process of lighting the lamp, to just drive home a simple message that for all the knowledge that we seek and acquire, it is essential that we first know, that we realize that we need to know more, and the new knowledge can happen only through a teacher. And today's teacher is not necessarily within the four walls of the classroom. Could also be an online teacher as well, an online guru as well. And we have to search for the guru very passionately, develop a very good, noble, harmonious relationship that ensures knowledge transfer between the teacher and the thought. And when we leave the guru, leave with a realization again that I just have learned a little bit and there is still a lot to learn. So this entire process is a lifelong learning process. And this relationship that a student has with a teacher is a relationship that will stay forever. A husband can get a divorce from a wife a divorce from a husband, and so on. But there is never a history. History will never recall that a student got a divorce from a teacher. That can never happen. Can never happen. And that is why, you know, for those who heard Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam, our former president, always talking about his school teacher, Sivasubramanian Iyer, whenever he delivers lectures. So that is the relation. And the student. And individuals need a set of noble values that institutions need to ensure that they have it embedded in their teaching learning ecosystem. Now, from individuals, if we move to institutions, see, in the shaping of an individual, four important stakeholders are very critical. One, parents. Two, the society at large. Three, the educational institution. Fourth is the law and order, the government. Now, today's world, parents are busy. And I wouldn't be surprised if there is something called, you know, parenting outsourcing. Maybe that's a separate industry that is also happening. So many of the parents are very happy outsourcing their responsibilities to somebody who's willing to do all of that. So it's becoming a tall order for expecting parents to shape their own wards, contours of discipline. Next is society. I have always felt that, you know, the society is an open air university. I mean, there is a lot that we can learn from our neighbors, our society. You know, when I was a school going kid, even if my parents were away or if the house was locked, I would take it as a matter of my right to go into my neighbor's house and then sit there and have my evening tiffin till my parents come back. Now, but today, you know, we live in certain societies where we don't even know who our neighbor is. Or we don't have even time to spend and engage with the society to come with new learning. So that also is becoming a tall order. Then education institutions, schools. The fourth one is law and order. I mean, nobody wants to be trained by law and order, which means that, I mean, you've done something so wrong that it requires law and order to fix you. I mean, we shouldn't go to that extreme. So the only beacon of hope that we have is in education institutions, because education institutions are now outsourced with the responsibility of building a values-driven individual as they leave the portals of the institutions. And that is why you see organizations taking so much credit, and they are so passionately driven by a set of values. You know, Johnson & Johnson, they have their own credo, or the Tata's code of ethics. So the organizational values, which is the institutional values, that are very, very important. Now, it might be an escapist route to say, you know, the society there is like this, students are like this, they are like this. So how do we expect institutions to create an impactful value change? See, there are problems everywhere. You know, you will have bumpy roads. You will have all the water problem, you will have hygiene problem, you will have healthcare problem. Every country will have its own problems, but that cannot make a country a problematic country. Likewise, every institution will have its own problems. But then we should channelize our positive resources. We should channelize our resources in a positive track to ensure that we have an institutional value-driven framework. In fact, when Mahatma Gandhi was so busy appreciating the good things that he's seeing about our country, you know, Ivan Mayo, when she wrote the book Mother India, I mean, it was kind of a book that trivialized the functional India itself. So people ran towards Gandhiji and said, Mahatma Gandhiji, this is a book that has kind of trivialized the virtuous and functional character of India. So Mahatma Gandhi said, look, I see so many good things around the world, around our own country, and I don't have time to look at the work of a gutter inspector. So he dismissed that book as the work of a gutter inspector and said, there are so many good things that are happening. And likewise, institutions have to look for many good things that are happening around them to build for themselves a value framework, which it needs to share with its own individual ecosystem, be it the teachers or the students. Now, how do institutions build that value framework? Now, for example, the immediate example that we have is our pandemic that has changed the very way in which we are defining, redefining the way in which we conduct our university processes. Everybody is talking about online, and to that extent that some of them have said, you know, online education is going to be the future. Of course, I have my own views on that. But at least today, you know, we are preparing ourselves to a situation where, as a teacher, when I ask my students, do you follow me in class? Now, a student says, yes, sir, I follow you on Twitter. Now, at least to that extent, he follows me. Whether he understood my subject or not, he's following me on Twitter. But, you know, those were the days where in your classroom, you would have seen a big notice board that says, you know, mobile phones not allowed inside the classroom. But today you cannot afford to say that because your classroom itself is inside the mobile phone. So that's the shift that has happened that is challenging institutions to build a unique set of value framework. And that value is different from a management perspective. What is the framework that you can create in this challenging online ecosystem that can generate value for the students, for the teachers, and for the critical stakeholders that surround you? So if you're going to look at institution as a chain of activities, every activity has the propensity to generate value. If you look at your enrollment process, the admission process, you are a central university, so naturally you are driven by meritocracy and, of course, all the policies when you do your admission process. There are many institutions that have commercialized education. So what is the value system that they might carry? So right from admission, enrollment, or recruitment, or the evaluation system, or the pedagogy, the teaching learning mechanisms, every such activity in a university or a higher education institution is a potential source of value generation. We have to unearth those values from every activities. If you look at the new education policy that was recently announced, it talks about interdisciplinary education, multidisciplinary education and research university, MERU. And from the introductory remarks of the vice chancellor, I can see a MERU in the making in the central university there at Thiruvarur. With so many schools, so many departments, we can have interdisciplinary studies. Now, what is the special value that you can create? If each department can generate individual values themselves, look at the aggregate value that all of the departments together can generate if they can develop the spirit and value of interdisciplinary education. So that is something that you can start thinking about, how to make CUTN a MERU university as envisaged by the new education policy. Or you can generate value by being more socially engaged. What are the social engagement models that you can bring about within the university because of your capacity to interact with the immediate society around you that can create sustainable livelihoods of so many people? How can we do translational research that can bring about a change in the socioeconomic capital of not only your proximal geography, but for the country at large? Or if you are an university, which I know you have your Institutional Innovation Council, how can we create the next generation of ideators and entrepreneurs? Can we be a university that creates the next generation of graduates who will be job givers and not job seekers. Today, we are living in a world where the gap between illiterate employers and literate employees is widening. Can CUTN shorten that gap? I'm not asking you to produce graduates who leave. Can they become entrepreneurs themselves? Why don't we shorten that gap? Now, these are things that institutions must start thinking about. How can we bring to place a value framework which has a multidimensional approach? Unless you have a multidimensional approach, you might be addressing certain spots of excellence. And the more and more multidimensional that you can get in any of these activities, but make sure it is in more than one of these activities, then the comity of the value output that you create aggregates and bundles together to kind of elevate, if you're going to measure the value generation from a status quo perspective, from X, it might be X plus delta X, but it can be 2X if all of the activities can get together to make sure that this comity of activities create a transformational shift in the value that you are creating. Now, next is about industry. I'll spend just a little time on that. You know, we have been very, and not that time rude, but we have, let me accept also, and I also, you know, we have been very shamelessly using that, you know, McKinsey study of 2004 that said, you know, only 25% of the engineering graduates are employable. Now, I don't want to go into the methodology of the study or anything, because that study was only based on the responses from a very the NASSCOM McKinsey study. We have been quoting it so often, and even today people are quoting about that. You know, are we telling ourselves to the industry, look, from 2004, since the study was then, and today we are in 2020, 16 years have gone by, and we have not added any value, and you're still quoting that study? No, the industry must start realizing that higher education institutions and schools, for that matter, have also equally taken up various challenging propositions, developed solutions, and has created an incremental value addition to the learning population by and large. But what is missing is a good relationship between the industry. And if you ask the industry why, they will blame the academy. If you ask the academics why, they will blame the industry. So it's been just a catch-22, each of us blaming each other. But then the time has come to understand that we need a symbiotic, osmotic relationship that ensures that it is a win-win for both. We don't need a one-sided relationship. Talking about a one-sided relationship in the lighter vein, I am just reminded of an old joke. You know, a couple, they were celebrating their 25th wedding anniversary. And, you know, the wife saw tears from the husband's eyes. And the wife, in an emotional outburst, said, "Oh, I am so happy to see you shedding tears of joy during our 25th wedding anniversary. And I am extremely lucky that I have a husband like you." Then the husband says, "No, no, those are not tears of joy. Remember 25 years back when your father was a judge, he caught us in a compromising position and gave me two options: go to jail or marry my daughter. Now I realize that, you know, I should have taken the first option, and I'm crying because I missed my first option." That should not be the type of relationship that we should be looking at. We should be looking at enduring relationships which are win-win with the industry for a very long period of time. And we have to start moving in that direction. I have seen enough reports, you know, developing industry, institute collaboration and all of that. But still, I feel that a framework that generates hidden value that is so bountifully available, both within the industry and an institution, is so much that the willingness of both to get together and unearth this value must start. So time has come, and whether it is the NEP or whatever be the policy, see, our way of looking at is we want policies to be framed. But in my view, you know, policy making is just intellectual paratroopy. You know, somebody there says this is the policy. That is essential. But as university stakeholders, as somebody who's working in industry, we should be doing a lot of foot soldiering. We don't need intellectual paratrooping. We need foot soldiering. And this foot soldiering can happen at our own levels. We can start something basic, engage with industry and start generating certain micro values on which we can build to generate a transformational shift that can come out of these collaborations. So friends, if you look at the way in which we can generate value, it can come from an individual's progress by way of enriching himself or herself with virtuous skill set, an institution's attempt to be identified as a value creator, and the institutions and industries handholding approach of taking both of them together and ensuring that the sum of both of their activities create additional value. So time has come to realize that it requires an effort from the individual, from the institution, from the industry, driven by policy, process, or people, or some of the efforts that are self-generated to create that value which has the propensity to incrementally elevate the socio-economic capital of our own institution, of our immediate society, of our community, of our state, of our country. So we have to start thinking new in this direction. Now, what is thinking new? What do you mean by thinking new? I would only want to end with a borrowed anecdote that one of my close friends usually uses when he talks about thinking new. Aurobindo spent a lot of time in Pondicherry after he came back to India. And pre-independence times in Pondicherry, you know, it was pitch darkness, suppressed. The intellectualism was suppressed by the colonial powers of those times. It was pitch darkness. And in the beaches of Pondicherry, Aurobindo was having tea with his friends. Then came this young mystic called Kullachami, about whom Subramanya Bharati has also referred to. So Kullachami runs to Aurobindo, snatches the teacup, empties the teacup, and gives it back to Aurobindo. Aurobindo looks at the teacup and says, "Yeah, I have got the solution." The friend says, "What do you mean you've got the solution? You have lost your tea." He says, "No, empty your thoughts, start thinking new." So friends, empty, unburden your existing thoughts if that is disturbing you a lot. There are new opportunities that are available. Start thinking new, because not only this pandemic, but also a variety of things that's happening outside is a big opportunity for us to think new. Because I feel that for a university of your type that is celebrating its decennial year this year, thinking new on this momentous occasion will give you a competitive edge. And when you celebrate your silver jubilee, your golden jubilee, or before that your bi-decennial, you will always feel that as an institution, you have grown from strength to strength because you have assimilated and aggregated all activities that have created values for a long, sustainable period of time. So thank you very much for this opportunity, and I wish you all well. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. We really are grateful for a very scintillating talk, I should say. It's been very motivating. May I pose a few questions to you? Yes. The first one is, you started off talking about policy, policy process and people. What happens when the leadership changes and the vision for the policy changes? How does an institute handle that? Because that's a typical problem when you have a change of leadership, especially in a governmental organization where the vision might not continue. So how do you ensure that?
The problem is in the understanding of a vision document. And usually we end up misunderstanding the vision document to be a very short-term objective. So the vision, as I said, you know, the Johnson & Johnson's credo is the institutional's vision. So whoever is the CEO of a J&J or whoever it is, they will make sure that the credo is not compromised. So if your institution's vision is long-term, and then all the other short-term are maybe of shorter durations, maybe driven by the leadership at that point of time. But the more and more an institution builds institutional safeguards on the vision that it wants to stay for a long period of time, the more and more they become successful. So it requires a vision that is questioning its relevance at any point of time. So it cannot be questioned at any point of time, and that's the vision that you should have in place. If you have a vision that can be compromised immediately, then that's not a vision statement. Maybe we have erred at the first stage itself in preparing a vision statement which has compromised on its durational endurability. So we should make it as long as possible. That doesn't mean that you will have to be unrealistic. But at least it has to be for a reasonable future to achieve a desired objective, which is definitely not something that can be done in 1 or 2 years. Maybe it requires a decade-long process, and you should make sure that there are safeguards for that.
That's institutional safeguards are something that is very, very effective. The second question that I really have is, you were talking about people being the foot soldiers.
Yeah.
Necessary. How do you ensure that they feel cherished in an educational institution? Because very often there is a sense of rejection that comes that the institute does not cherish the foot soldiers. So since you are a vice chancellor and also from the management, how do you ensure that your foot soldiers feel that they belong to the system?
Yeah, see, the challenge is the character of the institution also determines how much, the reward schemes and other incentives can be passed on. Maybe there are some processes which are also good, the CAS or the review mechanisms which we have for faculty, they are all in place. But then as a leader, you should not be just driven by rule book career review. Now, there are occasions where you can definitely, incentivize certain faculty with award schemes. In fact, the NEP, I was a member of the implementation committee constituted by the UGC, where we have also recommended that we should have some special track incentives, some special tenure provisions for aspirational faculty. Only then they get the feeling that their efforts are getting rewarded. But that's one part on the professional rewards and professional incentives. But always as a teacher, I have felt whenever I get an email from a student, thank you, sir, that your class that day really made the difference and I got a job. My day is made. And I'm sure many teachers like you or many of them have that momentary satisfaction when they get an email or when they get a good pat from their own superiors or a certificate of recognition, and all of this costs no money, just one big hat or some certificate of recognition. But we need to just ensure that after all, being a human, we only crave for that extra recognition for something that we have genuinely done voluntarily. If you're doing just things that you're supposed to do and you're expecting a reward for that, then definitely not. But if you're doing something on your own volition and that gets recognized, not necessarily in monetary perspective, but in different non-monetary ways, then yes, they will feel that, they have been rewarded. They will cherish that always. Because we are also matured enough to understand that the only way that we'll be satisfied is not just giving them a monetary incentive. Right. Today, we have started beginning to accept the fact that even a small word of congratulations, a quick pat on the back, I will be very happy. So we just have to build blocks that way.
Agreed. I mean, I completely agree with you. I have, this is a pet problem of mine. So I'm going to really ask you this question because outsourcing parenting and, you know, having taught little children, and I had a parent come and tell me that her 3-4-year-old daughter could not be wrong when I was trying to teach her dance, saying, "Yem ponnu tappu panna matta." I'm like, that's a 4-year-old kid. So this outsourcing parenting is a huge headache as a teacher. My question to you is the following. Teachers are already overburdened, and in multiple ways. Is it fair to put the value system onto the head of the teachers when the society / parents / everybody else is refusing to do that job? Is it even fair?
Yeah. So from rationing time perspective, it is unfair because we already are pressed for time. We have our professional commitments. But then that we are discharging a noble profession of teaching, we would be unfair if we just ignore that. So that is kind of, you know, embedded in the teaching profession. Now, if see what I always tell to the industry people, the institutions are already sandwiched between a failed schooling and an excessively aspirational industry. The industry says, you know, you teach everything before they come. And, you know, we have to start from scratch because the schools have failed to teach what they are supposed to teach.
Absolutely.
And all of this we have to do in 3 years or 4 years. It's very difficult. So the challenges for the institution itself is so huge. So I can imagine how the challenges for individual teachers would be. But instead of saying, instead of having a feeling of, you know, unfairness, maybe, you know, when I said how faculty need to reviewed. One was their contribution in elevating the value of the individual, in this case, the student. Yeah. If we are able to make a difference, and if that difference is also in a metric-based system highlighted, then, you know, I will be more than happy to do that. But of course, as a noble profession, we have to volunteer and do that. I wouldn't want a student to keep on erring, knowing fully well that he or she is on the erring track. Then, you know, my profession demands that I'll have to step in and fix the problem.
Absolutely.
And I cannot say, no, that's the parents' job, that's the society's job, it is not my job. Absolutely. So over a period of time, it is evolutionary and gets so embedded deeply into our profession that it becomes our main profession. You will never be surprised. You know? Then we'll stop teaching and then start preaching. And then finally, then you'll have the problem of, you know, oh, we have not completed our syllabus, and then get back to teaching also.
Absolutely. So I'm going to ask you the last question before I hand over the session to our Vice Chancellor. You spoke of industry. Now, while you are maybe slightly more conveniently geographically placed in getting industries, a place like Tiruvarur, which is in bang in the middle of agrarian lands, and we have no industry in sight, and we are also handling basic sciences unlike engineering. Is there any practical suggestion as to how we can improve our industry relationship?
Yeah. See, the very word industry itself doesn't mean about those listed in the Bombay Stock Exchange or any of the stock exchanges. If you look at the contribution to the India's GDP, more than 90% has come only from the non-formal business enterprises. So sitting in Tiruvarur, we can easily cherry pick some of the economic clusters. You have told it yourself, the agrarian cluster. So much activities happening in and around Tiruvarur that lacks a formal engagement with a university of your type. And when you can step in, you can definitely create value. Just imagine Central University at Tiruvarur, then Shastra, and then the Indian Food Processing Institute here at the IIFPT. All three get together. We have technology, they have storage, you have immediate knowledge on social science, behavior. We can all three get together. So all three of us get together can approach an industry, not necessarily outside our geography, but within the geography, water management in the Tiruvarur belt. How can we do that? So there is enough people who are willing to work with you. So the industry is just a broad term that I used, but I find that every entity in your immediate society is an economic unit. So the more and more that you can harness and enrich that economic unit, it means that you are contributing with an industrial relationship framework. Need not be, you know, a listed firm, need not have a share capital or anything. To me, even an agricultural landowner who tills his own land and produces something is an industrialist to me.
Thank you very much for your answers, because even from the YouTube chat, there are many people commenting that your answers are very, very pertinent. I now request our officiating Vice Chancellor, sir, can you please unmute yourself, and then I think you can take over.
So thank you, sir, for your very excellent and very informative and very enlightening, very thought-provoking. I can keep on adding many objectives, which are real. I mean what I say, and it is indeed a very splendid occasion for each and every one of us. And we really enjoyed your thoughtful delivery. Not only in terms of content, but also in terms of delivery. And let me just quickly summarize the highlights of what you have presented. You have started with Michael Porter, 1985, who proposed the concept of value chain. And the speaker has very rightly pointed out the generic nature of organization, and how policy, process, and people have to be put together. And the speaker also mentioned about individual as a stakeholder, institution as a stakeholder, industry as a stakeholder, and very relevantly, he has touched upon the issues in which we have no control. It happens in every institution. That is a big administrative problem. And sir, you have very rightly quoted from Swami Dayananda Saraswati's philosophical definition of values. As he has very rightly pointed out, Manjakudi is very close to our Central University of Tamil Nadu, hardly 10 minutes drive. So that way, it is very relevant that we get the philosophical sayings from Swami Dayananda Saraswati. And you have also pointed out the four yugas. Kali Yuga, and how very relevantly mentioned about the teacher's role as elevating the students, and the continuous learning of a teacher as a virtue of a teacher. I am mentioning the Haridas, who spelt out the role of the teacher and compared it to light the lamp. I just remained about Rabindranath Tagore also. Tagore has pointed out a lamp cannot light another lamp unless it continues to burn. A teacher cannot teach other students unless he or she continues to learn. So the moment the lamp stops burning, it becomes unfit to light another lamp. In the same way, the moment a teacher stops learning, he or she becomes unfit to teach. So it's a lifelong learning, continuous learning. We learn to live and live to learn. Vaazhvadharkaagave karkindrom, karpadharkaagave vaazhgindrom. So that way, another important thing you have very rightly pointed out, how we have to dispense with pride and vanity. Kattradhu kaiyalavu, kalladhu ulagalavu. So that is a very good observation you have made. And you have also pointed out the relationship between the teacher and the taught, and the importance of rapport between the teacher and the taught. That is a very important thing. One major strength of Gurukula system of education was that there was a very good rapport between the teacher and the taught. The teacher loved the students and vice versa. And that way, that affinity, that rapport, we cannot find in the modern age, in the modern institutions with the modern students. Everything has become very business-like, and that is the major source of ills of modern education, I can say. So, sir, you have also pointed out the roles of parent, the roles of society, roles of institution, and the roles of law and order. Parent, society, institution, and law and order in the inculcation of values. and very humorously, but very seriously, with lot of implications, they have pointed out the emerging trend of parenting outsourcing, which Dr. Madhurima also has discussed. And they have quoted about the organizational values, which tend to differ from one organization to another organization, like Johnson & Johnson, Tata Consultancy. And you have also mentioned about the employability of engineering graduates, and you have mentioned about the need for symbiotic win-win relationship. And ultimately, you have very rightly concluded about the need for thinking new, quoting from Sri Aurobindo in the pre-independent period, and quoting a very good example of emptying the teacup. You have spelt out the beautiful need for what is called unloading our unnecessary thoughts. Empty your thoughts, unburden your thoughts, and think of new opportunities. And you have very rightly concluded the Central University of Tamil Nadu also should think of new opportunities on the eve of completion of the 10 years. And that way, it is a very right message at the right occasion by a right person. And we are very much grateful to you. And I just have one observation or concern to share with you. As I quoted in the beginning of my welcome address to you, when I was a student of Annamalai University, we are Krishna Iyer, the learned Supreme Court judge. He delivered the convocation address. So beautiful, so inspiring. And you can never see a judge like V.R. Krishna Iyer, a person of that stature, that scholarship, more than a judge, a person of high scholarship. And he used to tell, not only in the convocation address, but in the other addresses also, we need today not only supreme intelligence, but superb love. We need today not only loaded learning, but utter integrity. We need today not only great heads, but good hearts. Not only great heads, but good hearts. So we need man, not a brilliant beast. So he concludes his message that institution is best, which cultures the heart and cultivates the mind, which teaches the man in the art of living and science of being. So that way, we find nowadays a value crisis, especially in Western countries. I can share one observation. When I was a visiting fellow in a university abroad, I just was waiting in front of the vice chancellor's chamber. I went to the office by morning 9 o'clock. And I saw a person sweeping the floor. And then after 9:30, I just was asked by the PA, personal secretary of the vice chancellor, to meet the vice chancellor. I was shocked when I saw the vice chancellor, because the vice chancellor was none other than the person who was sweeping the floor. And what the vice chancellor told is that in our university, we practice what we preach. Then only it will have everlasting impact upon the students. Today, it is the turn of the vice chancellor to sweep the floor. Tomorrow, it is the turn of the registrar to sweep the floor. And the day after tomorrow, it is the turn of the dean's heads. So that way, it is a cyclic process where we do self-reliance, self-dependent. That is what is advocated by our father of nation, Mahatma Gandhiji also. But my concern is that when I was a student, I came across a proverbial expression. If wealth is lost, something is lost. If health is lost, something is lost. If character is lost, everything is lost. But now, in the modern world, it is exactly the reverse. Now, what everybody thinks in the money-minded world, if character is lost, nothing is lost. If health is lost, nothing is lost. But if wealth is lost, everything is lost. So that way, some sort of money-minded orientation, that mental mindset has creeped in the minds of all the people, educated and uneducated, and whether we can do anything to address this issue. We came across different national policies on education, but in spite of that, we cannot make any change in the value system and in the values in the younger generations. That is the most important thing. And even the faculty members nowadays, the UGC has given the CIS performance-based, score-based assessment. So now what faculty members have started thinking, unless I do any activity which does not give me any score, why should I do that? So that way, it leads to some sort of self-centered, selfish attitude. That point is also there. And another thing, the NAAC parameters, accreditation, re-accreditation, recycle, first cycle, second cycle, assessment and accreditation, all these things, you know, they're all data-driven, only based on the data, what we give on the basis of the parameters of NAAC, but I don't think that they also give sufficient weightage for the value output of an institution, for which there should be measurable benchmarks, verifiable benchmarks, quantifiable parameters. So these are all the things which are to be addressed, and so that way, we are very happy that you have stimulated our mind through your brainstorming session, and we are very much thankful to you. And on behalf of the Central University of Tamil Nadu and on my own behalf, I take this opportunity once again to thank you. And this should not be the end of your contribution. And I look forward to your sustained contribution. As you have very rightly pointed out, we are all nearby institutions, sister institutions. Madhurima was asking about the possibility of industry in an agricultural rural background in Tanjavur district, in Thiruvarur district. Yeah, very relevantly pointed out. Institutions should come together. Bernard Shaw used to tell, if you give me an apple and if I give you an apple, we are left with one apple each. But if you give me an idea, if I give you an idea, we are left with two ideas. So this is the age of collaboration, not competition. So that way, institutions like Institution of Food Processing, Sastra University, and Central University of Tamil Nadu should come together for interdisciplinary, multidisciplinary, institutional, cross-institutional, multi-institutional research projects. And that way, I look forward to have many more avenues for our collaboration. I once again thank you. Thank you very much.
I'll take this opportunity to formally thank all of you for attending the talk, and to our appreciating Vice Chancellor for having invited a distinguished speaker, and especially to Dr. Vagi Subramanian today for first of all, changing the date and coming and addressing us today, knowing very well that this is our last working day. Thank you, sir, for the clarity of your thought, brevity of your words, and your punctuality. These are qualities that are rarely seen, especially in leadership nowadays. It's a truly happy note to be ending this year on, because it's a very inspiring talk and it has been wonderful. I wish you and everybody else who's attending, on behalf of myself and on behalf of the Central University of Tamil Nadu, a Merry Christmas and a very Happy New Year. Let's all hope and wish that 2021 is much better than what we have just seen. Thank you.
Likewise, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.